nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back to Unit 4 of our course on quantum transport. This is the fourth lecture. Now, in the last lecture, we talked about how you could write down these, self-energy matrices, the sigma or the gamma, describing different types of magnetic contacts. And in this context, I said that, something non-intuitive that's probably unfamiliar to most of you that you have to get used to is this concept of spinors, as opposed to vectors, which you are all familiar with. And when you have a this entity pointing along this direction n, theta and phi, as a vector, its component is described by these three real components. As a spinor, you have these two complex components. This we are all familiar with. This is standard vector algebra. This is non-intuitive. And for the moment, let's assume this. But what I'll try to do in this lecture is give you a little better feeling for where this came from. Now, for this purpose, it's, more convenient to think of a problem where the contacts are nothing, just both identical magnets. And ordinarily, you'd think that this would inject a spin in this direction, which would then flow out freely into the other one. And that's true if the H is non-magnetic, if the H has no spin-related properties. But let us think of what we'll be discussing is H, channels described by H, which actually affect the spin, so that even if the spin comes in pointing in this direction here, by the time it leaves, it has turned in some direction. Right? So what kind of property of H would make the spin do that as it travels through the channel? Now, usually the experiments we talk about are all steady state experiments. So you look at spatial variations. But for this purpose, it's more convenient to think of a short device. So the device is just one point. But think of, if you injected a spin here, what would it do as a function of time? Right? That's not the way the usual experiments are done, the ones we are talking about. But in terms of understanding the role of H, that's more convenient. So let's think of just a device with just two points, so that the H is described by, like for a non-magnetic channel, it would be epsilon, zero, zero, epsilon, epsilon's on the diagonal, and they're both equal. That's a non-magnetic channel. And then we'll talk about other possible types of H and ask the question that if you had a spin with components U and D at time equal to zero, how would it evolve with time? Okay? And as I said, experimentally, that behavior with time in a long device would be manifested as a evolution in space, because as the electron propagates, it would turn and so on. But this is the problem we'll be discussing in this lecture. Okay. So let's first start with the trivial case. How does this affect the direction of spin? Well, the basic, I took the IH bar out from here and divided it over there. So what you have is ddt up down epsilon over IH bar ud. So this is basically two separate differential equations. ddt of the up component is epsilon over IH bar times the up component, 1 times up plus 0 times down. And ddt of the down component is the same thing times the down component. And this has a simple exponential solution. So you could write the up component as a function of time is up at 0 times this exponential of that quantity times t. Similarly, the down component is exponential of that quantity times t, and these are identical. So what it means is that if you start out your spin looking like this, as time goes on, both up and down pick up the same phase factor. And one of the things I'd mentioned in the last lecture is that if you add any phase factor here, that doesn't change the direction in which the spin points. It still points in the same direction. So the moral of this story is that if you had an ordinary Hamiltonian described by this epsilon times I, which is a non-magnetic channel, nothing much would happen with time. The spin, if it is pointing in some direction, will stay that way forever. Now let us consider a non-trivial one where something will happen. And this is where we say that the H has the form of plus 1 and minus 1. So for one of them, it's positive epsilon z. The other case, it's minus epsilon z. But here also, there's no off-diagonal element. So we could write it out as two separate differential equations. And if you solve that one, you'll get up, will change, will evolve with time with that phase factor. The down will also evolve with time with the phase factor, but if one is minus, the other is plus. So now you see the up and down are picking up different phase factors as you go along in time. And so the direction of spin will also change. How will it change? Well, you see, originally at t equals 0, it was like this. Later times, this picks up exponential minus I epsilon z, and this picks up exponential plus I epsilon z. So it is as if the theta stayed fixed and the phi changed with time. So phi at t over 2 is equal to phi at 0 over 2 plus this epsilon z t over h bar. You see, these two exponentials, when you multiply them, the exponent adds. So the new phi over 2 is just the old phi over 2 times that factor. And of course, it's the same thing appearing here. Here it's minus, here it's plus. So the overall effect then of a Hamiltonian like this is to make the angle phi evolve with time, change linearly with time. So physically, what does that mean? So you have the spin pointing in some direction theta with the z-axis. With time, the theta stays the same, but the phi keeps changing. So it means this thing is going round and round around the z. So that's what you call precession. So if you had a Hamiltonian like this, one that gives you, affects the up and down differently with this plus one and minus one, then it will make the spin precess around the z direction. And this is the kind of Hamiltonian you actually get when you put a magnetic field. And that's something we'll talk about in the next lecture, but and doesn't concern us right now. But I just mention it because you may have heard that in a magnetic field, the spin wants to precess around the magnetic field. And what we kind of just showed is, if you had a Hamiltonian like this, the spin would indeed precess around the z direction. Now, and the rate at which it would precess, d phi dt, is this 2 epsilon z over h bar. So this is what you could define as omega. Omega is the angular frequency of precession. So in terms of this omega then, we could write the equation we had as d dt of up down is omega over 2i times this matrix, which we had defined earlier as the sigma z. That's the z component of the Pauli spin matrix, UD. And what this does is it makes the individual components change with time according to these two phase factors, which amounts to, I guess, the phi continually changing with time. Now, supposing we now want to describe in terms of vectors. So what I mean is this equation tells you how the up and down component of the spin are changes with time. But supposing we want to write an equation telling us how this vector itself changes with time. Well, you could do it like this. You know the x component of n is given by sine theta cosine phi. So how does it change with time? Well, if I take the derivative, I'll get minus sine theta sine phi and then d phi dt. Similarly, if I want to know how the y component changes with time, I'll get sine theta cosine phi, I'm taking the derivative of that, d dt of phi. So now you'll notice that sine theta sine phi is, of course, ny. So you can write minus ny omega, because d dt of phi is the omega. Similarly here, this is plus nx omega. So, and of course, if you look at the ddt of nz, there isn't any because there's no phi here. So it's just theta. So ddt of nz is 0. So you could collect all this and write it in the form of a matrix. ddt of nx is equal to minus ny times omega, right? So 0 times nx minus 1 times ny, 0 times nz. That's minus ny omega. Similarly, ddt of ny is this nx times omega. That's exactly what you have here. And ddt of nz is 0. So what we just showed was that if we were working in terms of the components of the vector, the ones we learn in vector algebra, then you would have written an equation like this. You see? And this matrix we could call the rotation matrix Rz. What it does is it takes that vector and rotates it around z. On the other hand, what we have is this spinor with two complex components, and this matrix has the same effect on it in terms of making it rotate. And if there's omega there, we have this omega over 2i here. But this has the same effect. It basically describes this rotation. Now, these two matrices, as you notice, will look very different. Now, next question you could ask is, what matrices would actually make it rotate around the x-axis, let's say? Now, in terms of vectors, that's easy to write, because from here, I could easily say, well, if you really want to rotate around the x-axis, what we should do is kind of move this thing down so that the x kind of becomes like the z with all zeros here. And this minus 1 just slides down here, the 1 slides down there, and you have the new matrix. So basically, you're just changing the x, y, z directions. So knowing this, knowing the matrix that rotates things around the z-axis, you can easily write down a matrix that rotates things around the x-axis. But here, it's not at all obvious what to do. Okay? And the correct answer is that the matrix that rotates around the x-axis is actually the sigma x, which is this other polyspin matrix with 0, 1, 1, 0. And there's no simple logical argument that would tell you how to look at this and write down this. So what is it then about these matrices that, you know, make this behave kind of like this and this behave like this? You know, although mathematically it looks very different. And this is what you'd learn in a, I guess if you read a description of this in a standard quantum mechanics text. The point you'd make here is that, you see, these rotation matrices basically obey, they have this very important property that Rx, Ry minus Ry, Rx, namely these matrices, when you multiply two of them, xy minus yx, you get rz. And so this is reflects the basic algebra of rotations. That is, when you take an object and rotate it around the x-axis a little bit and around the z-axis a little bit, that is different from if you rotated it in the reverse order, and the difference is exactly like rotating around the z-axis. So Ry followed by Rx is different from Rx followed by Ry, and the difference is Rz. And this is a very important property of this general algebra of rotations. And so if you want to have a consistent theory of these rotatable objects, then it is important that these sigmas, when you're trying to work with two complex components, also have the same property. Namely, just as Rx, Ry minus Ry, Rx was Rz, you need to have sigma x over 2i, sigma y over 2i, and the 2i is because of this difference of omega and this 2 omega over 2i here. Minus sigma y over 2i, sigma x over 2i should be sigma z over 2i, which amounts to this. So usually, as I said, if you read a quantum mechanics text, that's how the argument would go. It would start from this group theory of rotations, and you'd say that, well, this is the basic algebra of rotations. So if you want to represent a rotatable object with two complex components, first thing you need to do is find a set of 2 by 2 complex matrices which obey this property. And those are the properties that are obeyed by the Pauli spin matrices. So these Pauli spin matrices that I had written down earlier, they have this basic property. Sigma x sigma y minus sigma y sigma x is 2i sigma z. Similarly, sigma y sigma z minus sigma z sigma x, sigma y is 2i sigma x, and so on. So cyclically, they have that property. And once you have these matrices, then the way you interpret them is, this matrix rotates around the z-axis, this matrix rotates around the x-axis, this matrix rotates around the y-axis. And how do I get these components that I had mentioned earlier? You know, I said that something pointing in some direction has certain components. Well, the idea is that if you want a spinor that points along the z-axis, that spinor will be a eigenvector of sigma z. Why? Because if something points along the z-axis, then when you rotate it around the z-axis, nothing happens to it. Right? And that is what an eigenvector is like. So it is like this operating on a spinor that's pointing in the z direction has no effect on it. So it doesn't. And so a spinor pointing along z is an eigenvector of sigma z. And of course, this is a 2x2 matrix, so there are two eigenvectors. One is the plus c and the other is the minus c. Similarly, sigma x. If you want the spinor pointing along the x direction, well, it's an eigenvector of sigma x. And the two eigenvalues again, plus 1 and minus 1. The plus 1 gives you the plus x, minus 1 gives you the minus x. And the same here. So, in general then, if you want to write a spinor pointing along plus n or minus n, what you should do is construct this matrix sigma dot n. So if it n is z, you get sigma z. If it's x, you get sigma x. If it is in some arbitrary direction, it's some combination of these sigmas. And you take that matrix, find its eigenvectors. And that is how you normally deduce these results that I had stated earlier. So that's usually how it is developed in a standard quantum mechanics text. That first point is that rotatable, if in order to have a consistent theory of this rotatable object, you need to discover matrices which obey this commutation relation. These sigmas have that property. And then how do you find the components? Well, you look at the eigenvectors of these sigmas. And the plus 1 gives you a spin pointing in that direction, minus 1 gives you the spin pointing in the other direction. So that's a quick introduction then to this notion of vectors and spinors and the differences and the relationship. And what we'll now do is, in the next lecture, talk about spin-orbit coupling, this very important effect in channels which causes spins to precess and which can inside a channel and which can be used to control the flow of spins in spintronic devices. Thank you.